Okay. We're going to talk about something today that I think is extraordinarily important and extraordinarily current. It's about something that is actually happening in the world all around us today, and it's something that is wonderful. Adam had brought up this topic a little bit in his talk as one of his list of things that anarchists do. But this isn't just something that anarchists do. This is something that everyone can and is starting to do now. And what we're talking about are new ways to get educated. This is happening for school-aged children. It's happening for adults. It's happening for people who want, who are just looking for a new way to get work. The legacy school system, obviously everybody knows that it is a disaster, but it's not just the K-12. Also, the college system is becoming a disaster. People go to school for 4 years, 8 years, and spend tens of thousands of dollars and come out, and they still have to be an intern or whatever because, or they might not even be able to get hired at all in the thing that they majored in because the schools are not teaching the skills that people need to go and live out in the world. And this problem is being systematically solved all around us. And the reason why I'm introducing this is because I have a little bit of experience with this myself. But before I get to that, I listened to Tom Wood's podcast, and he has, this is just how I learned about some of the educational opportunities that are out there is from Tom Wood's. Everybody's probably aware that he has the Liberty Classroom, where he teaches people about history and other things related to liberty, which is, fun to learn that stuff. But he also does ads and promotes other people's educational websites. And one of them that he turned me on to was lynda.com, L-I-N-D-A. It's an unbelievable amount of content for doing kind of technical things. So I'm learning WordPress through lynda.com. They also have, web development. Tom Woods tells a story about someone who used another website called Code School. And within 6 months, they were able to land work in a new field. And these websites, they're not usually free, but when you compare $20,000 a year to $25 a month, it's unbelievable the quality of content for the price that you can get from these websites. And I actually, there's things about it that's better than a lecture. There's the rewind button, there's the text in front of you, there's you can pause it. So I'm building websites. I have Lynda in one screen, I have the website I'm building in the other screen, and the guy is telling me to do something and I'm doing it, and he's telling me too fast, so I slow him down, or I pause him, and then I keep working, and then he's telling me something I already know, so I speed him up to 125%, and he's talking really fast because I don't need to really concentrate because I know what he's saying already, but I still want to make him clear to speak up. There's just so much that that is out there now that it's going to replace the public school system. And I asked Jamie to come here and talk about something that he is doing to participate in this revolution in education technology that is going on right now. And Jamin is now a participant in this, helping bring it about. And Jamin's going to tell you all about it.
Great. Let me see here. Let's just try to gauge. Who here is familiar with Libre software, open source software, or Linux? Okay, cool. All right. Basically, if you're not familiar with open source software, it is a system that's open that can be changed and modified by whoever wants to do it and has the skill. And it's structured so it remains that way. So it's a lot harder to hide malicious code than software that the source code is constantly being poured over by people. And basically, constantly checked. So, I mean, that's the whole software where all this is coming from. It's all free and open source. And the important, the importance of the wording is when I'm saying free, I'm talking not free just purchase price. It's free to modify, free to use for whatever purposes you want to do. It's free to take chunks of and reconfigure it into something else. And, basically, it's the opposite of any of the state-connected software at this point. That basically, you don't own your device, you have your software on. And it's getting to the point where your devices that you buy are just basically supposed to be boxes locked down to where you can't have any access to securing them.
That's good. And even your car.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, so like the slideshow, I had some examples of some headlines about the newer cars using the newer onboard diagnostics that have Wi-Fi being hacked for people doing different malicious things to them. And there's always a lot of articles about back doors that are found in proprietary code, like Lenovo, a huge computer manufacturing company. There was a back door found in their BIOS code for some of their laptops, and that's a pretty big deal. That bypasses everything else. If something can get its hooks into that, they pretty much own the machine, no matter how secure your OS is at all. So, using Libre software as a counter-economic activity, what you're doing is you're taking away from the big software conglomerates that are connected to the state in like every way imaginable. Like they couldn't survive without the state at all in their present forms. If you just look at how much they leverage IP, pretty much makes my case. But so that's the problem, is the things that can happen when you don't have your code base to the point where people can look at it and people can find malicious things. Now unfortunately, almost all the devices people use are already compromised. And it's really hard to have a device that is completely open source down to the firmware on the hardware. But that's becoming something that's a thing now. There are some Lenovo laptops now that there is a open source BIOS that you can use for them. It's that part of the equation is in its infancy. But the actual OS software is what we're going to be talking about right now. And I'll be talking about specifically the package I have put together called Neuron. Neuron is made out of a collection of Linux packages. And Linux is the most popular of the open source alternative operating systems. But what we have here, it's basically an education project that combines free software, recycled hardware, easy-to-use interfaces into full-featured multimedia learning stations. So you're ready for toddlers to adults. The philosophy behind Neuron is termed low floor, wide walls, and high ceiling. Basically, it's to allow a very low floor and ease of entry for anybody to learn the machine just using their own intuition. And the high ceiling means the system is very, very capable, and it has no limitations beyond what's inherent in the actual technology that it's based on. And wide walls mean interoperability with other systems. These machines, they're a full-blown, the new Linux installed, and they're very compatible with other things, networking. So basically, I have some explanations, kind of train wreck about the slideshow here. I have notes on the slides. Alright, the whole point though is to get kids started on open source technology when they're young. And you know, that's one of the biggest issues for people to transition is the time lost. Like the I believe it's called a time loss fallacy. But basically it's, you know, people get very skilled in a certain suite of programs and operating system software, and they think they're going to have to relearn everything from scratch if they transition to something else. And these systems are made to overcome that. Like I've had luck with 3-year-olds sitting in front of it and doing stuff with it without any direction or anything. What enables that is I have a multi-tiered interface. There are 3 main accounts for the machine. And each account logs into a default interface that's age appropriate for the intended user of the account. So, a toddler, you would have them just show them to click on the icon with the rectangle, and they would log directly into a simplified menu driven with large buttons and a cartoon character interface. And when they get used to that, there are other interface options that build on that, and it's most of it's just intuitive and it sparks just the intrinsic curiosity to get into the system because it's so easy to use. And it doesn't stop. There's no real, like, being that it is like an entire Linux distribution, there's no real ceiling to it. These machines, like, for instance, there's a variant right there that is using a multi-track hard disk recorder with professional audio interface attached to it. I was using this one to give presentations here. When you log into the adult interface, you basically have every program most people would ever care to use for Linux and stuff. But I have like screenshots in here if anybody wants to check them out of the interfaces. And this is actually...
Can you turn the machine around?
So yeah, I'm going to do that. Get this start and current start. Okay. Is that video to be seen?
Yeah.
Okay. This is the first option, and it's GCompre, which is a huge educational project that has like over 200 activities, and constantly adding activities to it. What's kind of a little side note, if one of these machines were to spark somebody to get into coding, almost all the applications that I'm going to show you, the interface is made with a technology called QT. It's a development environment for making graphical interfaces. It's really popular right now for mobile device interfaces. So this, even the desktop of the operating system, is a high level of QT when you're customizing it So like somebody could very easily use this to learn QT on their own if they were so interested.
So you could like build apps?
Yeah, yeah, like all these apps are built from a toolkit, like their interfaces are. Like, for instance, this is GCompre, this is all QT. You can add more applications inside of this program with some simple QT scripting of some menu options. Like, but basically it has a lot of different things like that. That's why it has some other development stuff for kids. Okay, yeah, this is significant too. This is, there's a project called the One Laptop per Child Project. It is to give inexpensive laptops to like kids in the third world that are like super, super simple interface for like someone that might be even illiterate to just pick up these laptops, or they have tablets too, and just start using them to do stuff. But anyway, it was one of the inspirations. Not right now, honey. Why don't you try this one? Okay. But anyway. Oh crap.
She figured it out.
Okay.
Oh, I'm tired.
You can try it when you're done. How's that? But anyway, I can't get any more train wreck than that. Okay, this is Sugar. Sugar is the interface and the entire operating system for those. These have a mode that you can boot directly into Sugar. So they do everything the One Laptop or Child laptops do, but they are probably like 10 times more hardware than these cheap things are. So that's another option. This is the next option up for like toddler age experience group, and it is a custom interface made using KDE, but it's a QT interface, like I was saying, same development environment. But it has the big buttons, and it introduces a toolbar menu style system. There be gremlins. Well, so these are all other games that are included. Now, well, some of these are packages. Like Child's Play is another huge package. It probably has 30 to 40 activities in it. It's from some other university. These have a project called Debian EDU, which is a special collection of software for using Linux in educational institutions. It has Debian Junior, which is a meta package that is for early learning, and it has Sugar. Yeah, it has Sugar. Those are just some of the games it comes with. And of course, the first level interface does have a very capable media player with VLC player. This is the next level. This would be the next experience level. They actually have some drop-down menus. They have pretty much full access to all the applications, but they're still blocked out pretty well as far as user rights go. So they can't really post the system to that. And then we add all these professional applications like Office applications and graphics applications, music applications, and video, nonlinear video editors. And these are development environments for children to learn coding. There's like four of them. And then this is the adult level interface here. And this is just really full of lots of apps. Like that's what a lot of people don't understand that have an experience of like even someone handing them a Linux installer to check out like all the applications. You get a full complement of applications right from the install, versus with Windows you have to install each application separately. I mean, your App Store style interfaces are basically ripped off of the Linux package. Linux has been doing it that way for like 15 years. So, I mean,
these are all just basically all programs that already exist. And I don't understand what the incentive was when you came up with free. It's all open source. Why? Volunteering time to create programs?
Well, there's a certain amount of volunteering going on, but there are other avenues to get paid for that. One of the things is support. Like, for instance, I don't, like my model here, I'm not getting very much off of each laptop for what I sell them for. I'm hoping that maybe I get to do some support later and sell some support packages. And that's, you know, that would really be the long-term thing if I was trying to make this financially feasible. When people are doing an open source software project, that's one of the main things. And you end up having better code in the long run. So you're not, going the traditional way hiding your code away. You know, you're limiting yourself to the brain power that you have available right there to work on it.
So how safe is Linux to use?
Well, that's another thing.
You're familiar, right?
Well, it comes very locked down. Just by the way it was made. Like Linux is a true multi-user, multitasking operating system. And the way it works is it actually runs everything as a user. Like for instance, I don't know if you're familiar with any type of user rights management system where you have a user account and you have access to so much according to what the policies say you can have access to. Well, the way Linux works is it runs everything as a user. Like for instance, you have a user that monitors the power management of the system. You have a user that is called the disk user, has disk access. So it's so compartmentalized that way that you're always interacting with those things, and they're interacting within their realm. And so your standard user rights of an account of Linux don't really have a lot of access to stuff that can get messed up. Like if you're attacked. The first thing an attacker would do would be try to assume the root user so they'd have access to, more stuff. Root user on Linux is like the super user or administrator account that has access to the machine. So, I mean, that's... but it's also secure because in the actual kernel, it has firewall controls. It has IP filters. It has all sorts of stuff that are always working. You don't really... With Windows, you have to have a bunch of anti-malware stuff running.
Yeah.
And you have to have some type of better firewall.
There's
some that are
open source, like
C-Cleaner.
Yeah.
Linux, you typically don't run any anti-malware stuff. I mean, it's not just because people aren't making the software compatible, they're making malware for Linux. Linux evolved out of a multi-user system that had a lot more security in mind than what Windows evolved out of. Like Windows evolved out of your MS-DOS stuff, which was a single user, single tasking operating system, and they kept adding on to that concept. But in essence, it was a lot of the add-on stuff, basically, you know, they weren't doing it right from the get-go, and there was a lot of duct tape and zip ties, like under the hood of windows, for like the security controls and stuff like that. And there's a lot of statism too, if you look at it, because they were the only operating system for PCs that would get certified for DoD use. So that basically boosted popularity of Windows NT and made it so you couldn't have any type of competitors. So it was your basic barrier to entry that was likely lobbied for by Microsoft. So I mean, that's what gave it such a foothold in government and schooling, was that certification from the DoD.
Right, yeah, you can't go to college without like being forced to use all Microsoft stuff.
Yeah.
I remember it used to be Apple.
Yeah.
All the schools had Apple products.
Right.
Long after Windows was popular.
Yeah. Well, they aggressively market. Like, I've been in IT jobs where I've had to deal with like people marketing software and people stuff. And if you're someone that isn't like passionate about what you're doing, about just knowing what the hell you're doing, it's very easy to get talked into something by some pushy salesman who's selling crappy software. And so that's what, you know, Apple marketed aggressively to educational institutions. Yeah, they got that cycle going. And that's why they still have that foothold in a lot of graphic arts type stuff. But now, I mean, Linux is getting very good in that respect. Like this machine over here, that is my prototype digital audio workstation. And it just the way everything works together is really cool. It has a sound server that the audio programs connect to, and it makes it so you can string a ridiculous amount of programs together and all act like a single instrument. But like that used to be a weak area in open source of Linux, was having some good audio programs and some good video editors and some of the stuff that there wasn't as much motivation because people were just pirating the commercial programs anyway. The pirating of commercial programs, that actually helps them because they get a bigger install base, and then if you're actually doing it for any type of business, they do aggressively check licensing and stuff. Like I used to get calls about license violations and stuff, administration and stuff. They like to put the fear that they're going to come and audit their licenses, because nobody has enough licenses that I know of ever worked for, like for the Windows networks. Because you have to have client access license for a machine that's going to connect to the server. You're technically not allowed to have more machines connected to your server that you have access licenses and stuff. And it's ridiculous. It's what drove me to open source, was just dealing with their shit.
So you're using all the open source stuff on there and like making programs, taking pictures and
all those, and moving it, and like recording to share a picture with grandma, and grandma's got PC, with Microsoft, and everything in a transfer.
Yeah,
these
programs
will save in pretty much any file format that's out there.
So you can reopen
something. Yeah, like you just, the Office, it uses LibreOffice, which is an offshoot of the Office package Sun Microsystems used to use in their business packages for people who ran units. But anyway, they open sourced it, and there's a couple different foundations that put out the Office software, but I use LibreOffice on here. And it is file format compatible with Microsoft Office. So it has its own file format it saves at. It saves as an open document format, but it can read and write XLS, .doc, and .ppp, I mean .ppt, or PowerPoint, .xls. I'm able to read all that stuff and write it. Now sometimes, and this is something Microsoft does intentionally, is they break compatibility between versions with their new file formats. Sometimes they don't do anything different other than just screw with the code enough that all your Office compatible programs that aren't Microsoft choke on the new format. But that's usually fixed with the next update. So it's just a game. You know, it's a game they play.
Yeah, like I don't have time to keep my Windows program and everything.
Seems like they're attempting to create FUD around it so that people
can Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Oh. I don't know what else.
Where can I get a copy of your run?
Okay. Right now I don't have, it's like 15 or 17 gigs depending on the machine. So I don't really have any good media to distribute it. What I do is I buy lots of business class laptops and refurbish them. And I have like different levels. This is a $200 one. This started life as a $1,500 to $2,000 portable CAD workstation. And it's just old enough that it's inexpensive. Like it's a dual core, Core 2 Duo, like 2.5 gigahertz, so it's not like a slouch performance-wise. And it has 2 gigs of RAM, which is actually pretty decent for how kind to memory Linux is. But this is kind of the flagship machine I try to base them off these old Windows workstations, because they're also, they're a lot sturdier than like a consumer laptop. These are built to real spec drop specifications that are built to operate in extreme environments. But the I have $100 ones and $125 ones. The $100 ones are typically a older desktop replacement laptop, which is a business class machine that's rugged, and it was their attempt to replace a desktop machine when they put it out, so they usually have pretty good hardware for the time they were put out. I actually, like that one over there, that is like two models newer than this, and I haven't maxed out the capabilities with their GMI. It only has 4 gigs of RAM, and it'll do 16 stereo tracks at like 5 milliseconds latency. Oh yeah, you generally can get by with half the amount of memory as a general a 4 gig machine will feel like an 8 gig Windows machine. And actually you don't even see that much improvement after you really pile the memory on. Unless you do some cache figuring the drives and stuff. But yeah, the thing is I have like all models of them. I have some nice Lenovo portable ones that are a little thinner, for 125. And I try to get stuff that is really almost like new condition, like these machines are really nice. I didn't want to sell them, I wanted to keep them all and make stuff out of it. I need to set top box out one again. I replaced my aging home theater PC. And it's just a basic neural install and I installed Chrome and put it so we played Netflix and see if we change it. Basically, that's what we watch on our TV. Because, like, you know, this model has an HDMI out. They have a website. I got a website on the card. Check out if you're interested. It has some examples of machines I've sold. I haven't got past the first run of them, so I probably have maybe 10 of them left or something in different types. But after I sell those, the plan is to try to find a higher quantity of the workstation classifiers, because that's so awesome.
Thank you.